The hearts and minds of the people of the world have devised many different ways to give themselves passage into the afterlife, and many different religions have formed from their imaginations. Of course, they have had Satan's help in forming their blasphemes, and all except for a small flock have bought into these different ideas in order to feel at ease with their temporal existence here in the flesh. Even those who say that they do not believe in an afterlife have still given themselves peace of mind that they will simply be dead one day. Just look at all of the religious confusion that there is in the world today. I have primarily been speaking about the religion of Christianity because I have been sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, so my focus has not been on the other crazy beliefs that are in the world. But one thing is certain, they all believe that they have it correct. Even within the thousands of different beliefs that are found in Christianity, they all believe that they have it right. They believe that they have the spirit of Elohim guiding them, and they all believe that they are on the path to eternal life. If they didn't, they would switch paths. So, since we know that our Elohim is all powerful and we know that he is not divided, this should show you that Satan is very deceptive. After all, if our Creator is not divided, all of these different beliefs cannot be correct. So, and his word says, no lie is of the truth. So, pretty clear that there's a bunch of people deceived if you just looked at it from that standpoint. Only one group could be true. What is mind-boggling is, knowing that Satan is so capable of being deceptive, one would think that each of us would fear with all of our being that maybe we are the ones that are deceived. At least this would be the case if we really feared being wrong and if we feared missing out on the afterlife. But the reality is, people do not fear being wrong. The world wants to believe what they are comfortable with, and this is most often somewhat in line with what they grew up believing. This includes those in Christianity. This shows the importance of teaching our children the truth. The problem is, we have to first have the truth in order to teach it to our children. Otherwise, we are just teaching them to live lies. If we teach them what we believe to be true and it is not true, then we are leading them to a different path than the one that leads to eternal life. And this is what has happened. The scattered nations of Israel left the truth that was given to them, and they passed down their counterfeits of it to their children, and the lies have flourished. Some believe that there are many paths to eternal life. In order to believe this, you certainly have to choose not to believe Elohim's prophets and his son. They taught clearly that there is one path. With all of the religious confusion that there is in the world today, and even within Christianity, it is obvious that somewhere along the line things went astray, and they did. It happened in the garden with the original parents when they chose not to obey their Creator and they chose to decide right from wrong for themselves. Let's just suppose that the prophets' writings that are found in what the Christian Bibles call the Old Testament are true. And let's just suppose that the writings of the eyewitnesses, Matthew and John, are also true. If they are, then the purpose for us being here is defined. These writings show our Creator calling a people back to him from a broken state. A broken state that started in the garden. You look at the stories with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and he called them, Moses records, through his Torah. Exodus 19 verses 5 and 6, it says, from this time you will hear, if you will hear and obey my voice and guard my covenant, you will be a special treasure to me of all of the people, because all of the earth is mine, and you will be a kingdom of priests and a nation of saints to me. Does this fit the description of any religious group in the world today? Do you know of such a group of people who are hearing and obeying his voice and hedging about his covenant? Do you know of such a group of people that have his Torah written on their heart, in their hearts? Since that was to accompany the new covenant? It seems that it is hard for most people to understand that he created us to have eternal life on a conditional basis. The condition is that we become like he is. He has free will, therefore his mold to fashion us in his image had to start by giving us free will as well. This simply had to be in order for him to reproduce his character in us. There was no other way for him to accomplish fashioning us in his image. This means that we had to be given the ability to not choose to be as he is. He created Satan and those who followed him for the purpose of presenting an opposing system. Satan and his crew were created by design. Evil was by design. All things like adultery, homosexuality, lying, sickness, disease, and even death is by design. Those who will become part of his family that he is building must enter into a contract with him to be set apart from these things to become as he is. We must be priests in training. His life is a training camp. Of course, we don't have to show up for it. We have that choice. He gave us his word to accomplish the end product of making us in his image in us. This life in the flesh that he gives us is a testing and a proving ground for the afterlife. How awesome it's going to be. We even have male and female hormones given to us as a part of this test. I'll use this for an example. I had one person a while back try and justify their response to their hormones by blaming him for making them this way. Crazy. This person missed the point. And he was being shown the truth too, but he departed from it for having attitudes like this. We are here to overcome. Yeshua was explaining to his disciples about divorce and remarriage, and they inquired of him if it is better then that we not marry. And he said to them in Matthew 19, verses 11, 12, all men cannot receive this saying except those to whom it is given. For there are some eunuchs that are castrated people which were born so from their mother's womb, and there are some eunuchs which were made eunuchs of men, and there are eunuchs which have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. He that is able to receive this, let him receive it. He gave this example because he knew that some have such a problem with their hormones that they choose to have themselves castrated so that their problem would not keep them from his father's kingdom. They wanted the kingdom with all their being. They didn't want anything to get in the way of it. They made themselves this way so that they would not stumble. He told us that if our right eye causes us to sin, then pluck it out, because it is better to enter in the kingdom with one eye than to not enter into it. What Christianity cannot seem to receive is sin is transgression of our Creator's instructions. So how the Bible defines it. But instead of hearkening to our Creator's instructions, Christianity would rather give themselves eternal life by saying that they are saved by grace apart from needing to become our Creator's righteousness. This is insanity, and it defies why we were created. You have to ignore our Creator and His Son and what they spoke in order to believe such foolishness. Yeshua plainly told us that the continuance of the saints is those who keep His Father's commandments and have the same belief that He has. If you believe in a Messiah that died so that you do not need to keep His Father's commandments, you believe in a make-believe Messiah, and you do not believe in Him. He was His Father's ward. He still is. It's the name He was given. And you do not have the same belief He has if you believe this way. He believes His Father's ward, and He became it. If you think that His Father's commandments that He told us to keep are not those that are recorded in His Torah, you simply do not believe Him or His Father's other servants, because they spoke clearly what we're to obey. There are many scriptures that prove and define what Yeshua meant when He said that He did not come to get rid of one punctuation mark from His Father's Torah, when He said that we're to live by every word of His Father's. Pretty clear. The prophecies say that Yahweh would raise one up from out of the captivity and send him to the scattered nations of Israel with his message in the last days. This message would be to return to Him by returning to His Torah with the statutes and judgments at this time. These prophecies actually prove that His word is true, because they could not possibly match real time like they do if they were not true. And they also prove that the scattered nations of Israel are in captivity to Christianity this time. I've spoken on this in several of these videos. The proof is overwhelming, cannot be refuted. I do not know how any of you can say differently if you examine the evidence that He gave us in His word. I certainly do not know how any Anyone can say that the statutes, ordinances, judgments, and precepts of the Torah were done away with? Not one thing in his word defends this belief. In order to make this claim, you have to say that the eyewitnesses lied and that the prophet's writings that Yeshua bore witness to are false. Therefore, you have to say that Yeshua's journey here was false. You have to throw out all of the true scriptures that our Messiah testified to in order to make this claim. And if you do this, then you have also just thrown out the proof that he was and is the Messiah. So look at your hypocrisy. He said that he was sent to bear witness to the truth, and he did. He magnified his father's Torah, just like Isaiah prophesied that he would. A couple of days ago, I read to you where our Creator defined his parable about the sour grapes. In this parable, he made it clear that he was saying that the righteous who will live are those who keep his statutes and judgments and ordinances. He listed some of them so that there would be no confusion and no doubt who will live. He said that the rest will die. They will die because they are drunk with the wine of fornication. This wine is made with the sour grapes. These grapes are rebellion to him. They come from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Feeding off of this fruit is committing adultery to him. And this is exactly the drunken stupor that the third of the world that calls himself Christians are in. They are staggering toward the lakes of fire to the lake of fire with no fear that they are committing adultery with their Maker. They have chosen not to become his saints. Yes, the other two-thirds of the world is deceived as well, but they did not have his instructions given to them like you did. You were supposed to bring the truth to them and teach it to them. Yeshua gave us the command to do this, and it's known as the Great Commission. He said to baptize them and to teach them to obey every word that was given. Instead, you attempted to bring the sour grapes to them so that they could be drunk with rebellion with you. You brought the message, just give your hearts to Jesus and you'll be saved and you'll be born again, or some other blasphemous version of this. Here's a challenge for you. Take Saul's and his followers, Luke and Mark's writings away from your rebuttal to what I'm speaking, and refute what I'm saying with the word of Elohim. You cannot. No one even tries this because they cannot. Christianity is a bunch of non-believers who hide behind the teachings of the abomination of desolation, Saul, and they are cowards for not obeying their Creator and putting their eternity in his hands. We were created to become as he is. You cannot get around this if you believe him and his word. He commanded us to become perfect to him. He commanded us to become set apart to him and to obey him and to cleave to him and to become his saints by living his every word. His son commanded us to do the same. How do you refute this? Sanity is willful rebellion. He did not shed his blood to get rid of the perfecting process that his father gave us. He delighted in his father's perfecting process, just as all who became his father's saints delighted in it. He shed his blood so that we could be forgiven, so that we could re-enter into the perfecting process through his blood, because we were already cast out from his father. Atonement needed to be made. In what is called the New Testament, there is primarily the record of Yeshua coming to the tribe of Judah, but he went to all of the tribes with the restored covenant. Scriptures say so. And even though Judah still had a form of the commandments when he came, they were already in captivity as well. They just were not dispersed yet. They were certainly cut off from his father, except those isolated few that there have continued to be over time. This has continued with the other lost tribes as well. He offered all of the tribes a way to return to a covenant with his father, and he shed his blood so that all who would return to him could be atoned for through it. Repentance, or returning to him, is required for his blood to be applied on our behalf. How are you molded to be one of his saints if you refuse both the master potter and his textbook, and you refuse to even be his clay? The answer is you cannot. He is telling you that it is time to stop trampling his son's shed blood under your feet and return to him. He says, come out of the whoredom, my people, and I will be your Elohim, and you will be my people. and you will be a special treasure unto me, and you will be a kingdom of priests and a nation of saints to me. What he is offering is a very good deal. It always has been, but most have rejected it. His offer has conditions, but they are a delight because they are walking with him and walking with his son to be in agreement with them. This is a very good offer indeed.